How's it going, buds? I'm Arthur Eby. Learning how to use Photoshop is a valuable skill in today's world, and learning how to Photoshop your transcripts is a fun and easy way to get started.
So, start by scanning your transcripts or obtain a digital file and open it in Photoshop. Use Command Plus a few times to zoom in. Here we see a D plus in discrete mathematics. Erase this D plus with the clone stamp tool. Shift-click in an area with the background, and Photoshop's intelligent pattern recognition technology will pick it up. Then, click anywhere, and Photoshop will repeat the pattern. Now, we'll shift-click in the region with the lighter-colored pattern and repeat the process. This coordinate right here shows what part is being copied from the pattern. It shows the relative position from where you last shift-clicked. Now, find an A from another course you took, and select the Magic Wand tool. Click inside the A and Photoshop will draw a selecting line around it. Make two copies by selecting Command J twice. Now, make sure you have one of the A layers selected and move the A up to the empty space. The other copy keeps it right in line with the others, and other Photoshop features help you get it right where it needs to be. Remember that the A will now change your grade points, your semester GPA, and your cumulative GPA, so use the same erasing, copying techniques to adjust these numbers according to your school's grading system. You can also use this technique to replace all your other bad grades with A's. If you don't have any A's, that's fine. Select a region of text with the Marquee tool, go to Type, Match Font, and Photoshop will give you a list of fonts that are similar to it. You may have to try out a few, but soon you'll find one that matches perfectly. You can give yourself as many A's as you want, or you can type whole new classes that you never took. Save the file as a PDF, and nobody will be able to tell that it went through Photoshop.
Now, of course, Photoshopping your transcripts would give you an unfair advantage, right? But maybe that's not what it's for. Maybe it's just a simple representation of art, a fun way to learn how to use Photoshop. It might make you feel better. It might even save your life. Dozens of students have committed suicide, seemingly just over their grades. Take Madison Holleran, for example, who jumped to her death supposedly because her 3.5 GPA at Penn State was just not acceptable. She had a loving family, no previous mental issues, and even just a few hours before her jump, she talked with people normally as if there was no problem whatsoever. Why would she take her own life? Well, we are constantly weighing the odds of everything, to sit or stand, to be or not to be. By weighing the odds, we find the route with the highest value. Really, taking the weight of something and taking the value of something is kind of the same thing. A pound is both a unit of weight and a type of currency because, for most of human history, things with higher weight were considered higher value. The average weight of an adult human is 137 pounds, but how much is it worth? Well, if you added up all of the carbon and oxygen, hydrogen, iron, and other elements in you, it would only add up to about $160. But if we don't break you down to the constituent elements of you, you would be worth a lot more. You have molecules in you, like adrenaline, which you can buy on SigmaAldrich.com for $30 per milligram. And if we take into account all of your organs, you're worth about $500,000. A heart is worth about $75,000. A liver, $50,000. However, there is no hospital price for a brain. That's because brains can't be transplanted. And if they could, you wouldn't want one anyways. You would be a completely different person. But on average, labs and universities pay about $600 for a brain to research. While you're alive, you can make about $8,000 for getting an advertising tattoo for websites. But you never can know exactly how much you're worth. We have a gauge to measure how much food we are ingesting, but we don't have a way to measure how much adrenaline we have in our adrenal glands. Thanks to the Human Genome Project, we know all of the 25,000 genes that a human is capable of having, but we don't know all of the different types of proteins and enzymes that the human body is capable of producing. So far, we've discovered about 50,000 different types of human proteins, but it's estimated that the human body is capable of producing over 2 million different types of proteins. The proteins and enzymes that we know about now have extraordinary mechanisms to keep us alive and well. For example, in order for you to absorb iron, the human body produces lactoferrin and transferrin. These are enzymes that bind to iron with high strength faster than the bacteria in your own gut can bind to iron. If a gut bacteria tries to take any iron from you, lactoferrin can attach to the bacterial cell wall, rip it open, take back any iron it may have, and kill the bacterium. Lactoferrin can also communicate with phagosomes, large cells in you that eat other cells. They can completely envelop bacterial cells, rapidly destroy them, recycle their proteins, take back any valuable metals they may have, and digest them whole. At the cellular level, iron is as valuable as gold, and your body is constantly at war with the bacteria in your own gut, making sure you win the war for iron. Always. Now, when you've gotten enough iron to eat, your body shuts off that whole iron absorption process, but you still need to deprive the bacteria in your gut from iron. We need some of those gut bacteria in order to help us digest our food, but if you give them too much, they will multiply to an unsafe level. Thankfully, you thought of that too. You produce ferritin, a protein which absorbs iron like a sponge in times when you have too much. Then, in times when you haven't gotten enough iron to eat, it releases it back to you. There's a similar mechanism in you to help you absorb every other element that you need, every other nutrient, and a similar sophisticated set of mechanisms to help you do everything, really. There are enzymes to remember, enzymes to forget, enzymes that we don't really know the function of, enzymes that help you do things you don't even know you can do. And you probably never will know. Maybe the next greatest advancement is the Human Proteome Project, a project to know every single type of protein that a human is capable of producing. Right now, we're discovering about 10,000 new proteins every year. At that rate, we won't complete the Human Proteome Project for at least another 200 years. So for as long as you live, you will always have something new to discover about yourself, and you will always be worth more than you believe. But value is a relative thing. It's only what we make it, and it's different for every person. Gold and silver are two of the only things that everyone can really agree on the value of. They occur in small amounts all over the world, along with platinum, palladium, osmium, iridium, and other elements in the platinum group. Your body doesn't absorb any of these metals. You have no need for them. Your body absorbs cheap metals and leaves behind expensive metals. In a way, you are a walking gold refinery. The American Chemical Society did some studies on this and found that a city of 1 million people flushes $13 million worth of gold and silver and other precious metals down the toilet every year. They concluded that 1 ton of human sewage is worth about $280. Now, that's not a lot, but consider how much the Kennecott mine in Utah gets. They go through 55 million tons of rock per year, and out of all of that, they get 400,000 ounces of gold, 4 million ounces of silver, and 240,000 tons of copper. Taking into account the current prices for all of those metals, yields only $39 per ton. Even the richest gold mine in the world, the Grasberg mine of Indonesia, only gets about $75 per ton. Even if we could only get 1/3 of the precious metal's value from human sewage, it would still be worth more than you would get from any mine. It just goes to show how that most valuable source of gold and silver is not in the Kennecott mine or the Grasberg mine or any other mine that you could search for on Earth. It's in you. So embrace the future, be a part of it, and